This conference will now be recorded.
Asha, one question, Asha.
Sorry, that is not audible. You're not audible. Come again.
Can you hear me, Asha, now?
I can hear you.
Yeah, one question, Asha. You have given us like some work, right? The prior insurance drop down that you have given us two tasks. The add new controls for like the previous insurer. We were able to do that, all that stuff, but when I create the when condition for other insurer, previous insurer is equal to other, in that drop down, when I click other things, I'm not getting that other.
You need to check that when condition because you are designing it, right?
Yeah,
maybe
I did. And I double clicked on that self property and visibility. I kept there. Prior insurer is equal to other.
It is case sensitive. Value of other is case sensitive. How you have given in the local list, same way it has to be. So there is no hurry. You just take your time and think about it. Here again, what you have done and troubleshoot it. Take your time.
Okay.
Because otherwise you just leave it and in other application.
I can see that the problem is like when I select the other, it's not coming up. When I select the previous insurance or something, it's coming up. I think something I messed up there.
Yeah, something you have to check there. Maybe when conditions, what are the rules involved? Which rule is not properly behaving as per the requirement? You just check it. You take your time, no worry, and do it.
Okay.
Online resources, anyone else has any other questions? Someone else was asked. Okay, let's go ahead now. Today we thought of discussing about some general process in the organization, your application development process, which is for everyone. So if you are already aware of all this process, that is fair enough. So those who are not aware of, just try to understand here. So let me start from here. Like in any application development, as a developer, if you join any organization as a developer, you will be given with business requirements documents. Okay, you will be given with business requirements documents. For that, they can use some tools. Okay, it is not Pega BRPC, some other tool. That means you are working on insurance application, so and so screen has to be created. For that, they will be writing the requirements. Business will be writing the requirements, and business has to give the requirements to developers. So the in order to maintain these requirements, they will be using some tools. What are the possible tools that you are aware of? What are the tools? Jira. What is that?
Ruby.
Rally.
Yeah. Some other tools like this, some they will be using. Means if they create a Word document or Excel document of requirements, they will create a new task in that tool and they will upload that as a header. Now you will be having access to the tool and you can access and download. That will be assigned on some name. So in the tool, if you see, there will be a name. So after they create a task is created, document of requirements is uploaded in the tool. One drop down will be there, list of assignees. So your name will be there, your employer ID name will be there. Once they have assigned you, you might be getting email notification and all. Okay, they may assign directly or they may not assign. First of all, who will create these requirements and who will give to developers? So generally, what requirement is needed for the business application development will be decided by business team. So actual business, suppose Amazon application, Amazon business owner will be there. So the requirements should come from approval with business owners. There will be some team that is going to work on gathering these requirements, so which are required for future purpose and all. They will get all the approvals done at the business end. Now business will never directly communicate with the developers teams, service provider teams, organizations. In between business and developers, let's say here, there will be another person called business analyst will be there. So business analyst is going to talk to business for any need, and get the details passed to developers. So this is the person who is going to act as an intermediate guy between developers and business. If you need any clarification, anything about business requirements that are being assigned to you, you need to talk to your team. Means you need to first talk to your team lead and then tech lead and then business analyst you have to go through. So business analyst will talk to business and get the clarifications and given to developers. You will never communicate with business in most of the situations. Okay, you will always be in touch with business analyst. Okay, so now business analyst is the one who is going to access these requirements tools and all. He is going to upload the documents of business requirements and he is going to assign to maybe your tech lead. Okay, see your development, this is one part. And now how your development will be done in real time. So given, suppose you have a project, that project has to follow a methodology, software development methodology. So this can be waterfall or this can be Scrum methodology. So waterfall is not needed to be discussed now. Let's go ahead and discuss about Scrum methodology. So Scrum methodology means this methodology is going to have the development life cycle, how it should proceed will be defined. That is, so you will be getting the requirements. Requirement has to be analyzed quickly, and then development, and then unit testing, QA testing, UAT testing, and then go live. So this is what. So apart from this, this is development phase. Apart from this, analysis development, at some certain point of time, you will be having discussions. Okay, discussions means daily status calls, review calls, daily status, or you say review calls. So what you have done, all that has to be discussed. So some organizations, it is everyday call, everyday evening time, or maybe once in 2 days, something like that. So mostly it is everyday, you'll be having this daily status calls. See, whenever the requirement is uploaded to Jira tool, so it will be accessed. In some organizations, everyone can access, but few organizations, suppose when I worked in Cognizant, only my tech lead used to access that, and he is going to send us an email, the documents. So now, for this, when you are following Scrum methodology, your development will be divided into sprints. It is called as sprint. That means one sprint is equal to, let's say, 15 days. See, that means 15 days is the time period where first day you'll be getting, day one you'll be getting requirements and you have to analyze and implement it, unit test it and send it to QA. QA will complete the testing and it has to go live. Means here you see production deployments frequently happening, 15 days once or monthly once like that. Okay, so this is how your model. So you get the requirements, do work on the requirement design, unit test completed, and then the coding, whatever the team, entire team has done, everything will be QA tested, and after that a regression testing will happen in UAT environment. Finally it will move to live. So like this, there will be sprints that you have to that you are going to follow. So once you get the requirements being added to Jira tool, now your tech lead may access that and there will be a discussion on the requirements, initial call, okay, if needed. Okay, so now these are all the requirements added for this sprint. This is day one. Generally they will add 1 or 2 days before only. During that window when testing is going on, next sprint requirements will come generally. So now they, so business analyst and your team, everyone in your team, business analyst is going to join the call and you guys are going to discuss what are the requirements that are being added, will be told to you by business analyst. This is the requirement for this purpose, this is the requirement for this purpose. It will be aligned. And now your tech lead will decide on taking the requirements, whom to assign this, talking to your team lead. If your team lead is tech lead different, then he's going to communicate with team leads and team. And let's say 5 requirements added, you are 5 members in the team. So 1 requirement will be given to each team member. Okay, now you will get the requirement. Maybe by accessing this tool directly, you can download that. If you don't have been, if you're not being given with access, they will send you on your email with a requirement document, which is an Excel document, or it can be Word document also, but Excel document mostly, which will be having story points. So will be there. It means requirements 1, 2, 3, 4, like this, it will be written. And I'm not going to talk about efforts and all, how many hours it will take, that is not required. No, this is just basically general process. During this process, suppose you have gone, you are been assigned with a requirement, you didn't understand something. So complete details about functionality will be known only to business analyst. Completely business analyst will come to know about it. Suppose if business analyst also do not know about it, business will come to know about it. So your communication should be, first point of contact should be your team lead. Anything you don't know, first point of contact is team lead. Go to team lead and talk to him. He is also not pretty much aware of that. He will go to tech lead. So not sure, then all of you will be joining, will be sending an email to business analyst, joining a call with business analyst and getting the clarification from there. Business analyst also do not know during that call, he will go back to business and talk to them and get the clarification and given to you. Okay, this is just general process. Now my point here is, in the development, how it will be proceeded. See, your development will be done on development servers. That means Pega BRPC application has to be developed. So Pega BRPC product, the installation which we have done, right? This product installation will be done on multiple machines. Okay, multiple servers. When it's a server, machine is server. Now Pega BRPC is installed on server 1, machine 1, machine 2, machine 3, machine 4. Like this, n number of servers, this will be deployed. Let's take 4 environments now. There can be more than this, post-production like that, but I'm not going to talk about all that. So here you go with. So first server, they will treat this server as development server. Development server means all the developers will log into this server using a URL and open VRPC environment and work on that development task. So next one, this is for what? Whom? This is for developers. Okay, next one. This is QA server, quality analyst. This is for whom? Testers will access. Testers will be able to log into this server and they will be able to access the application and test it. And the next one is user acceptance testing. You can get the abbreviations in Google also. This will be accessed by QA, plus business analyst also will log in for testing and do the regression testing. After everything is completed, business analyst also made run test cases and then get the results. And this is called as prod server, production server, or you can say live server. Okay, who is going to access this one? Actual end users. End users means business users. Amazon application we are accessing, right? We are end users. Amazon application will not be developed on the same server where we are accessing the application from. It will be developed on development server. So now in a sprint, your development is done, completed. You have done unit testing, everything is completed. So unit testing, once you do, you write all the test cases and work out your IDs and the result which you have got. Everything should be documented and it has to be placed somewhere in the common path or should be uploaded. Now your code is completed in development environment, and from development environment, the code will be moved to next level of the environment. That is, next level is QA environment. So code will be moved. So that, how to do the deployment and all, I'll tell you. So the rules which you create here, everything will be extracted as a zip file. That zip file will be imported in QA server. Now testers are going to test this. So from here, after the testers say that everything is fine, the same code will be moved to UAT in case if everything is fine. Okay, so UAT means user acceptance testing. Here the test cases that they run may be limited number of test cases specific to the functionalities, little more than that. User acceptance testing, it is a regression testing that will be done. Okay, so that means apart from your requirements, whether there are any other business functionalities which are already available or getting impacted, they will be having some specific functionality to verify, and some performance testing, everything will be done here, everything. So if everything is fine in UAT environment, then the code will be taken to live environment. So live environment, once you do the deployment, everything is completed, business analyst again, once again, they'll be testing. No one will access. Some organizations, business analyst will access it to create one or two test cases and delete that with test data. So once business analyst gives approval here, it means everything is okay. Okay, any issues, then it has to be rolled back. Old code should be deployed. That is a different case. Now, if any issues in QA, suppose QA testers are testing for more information, there are some issues they have identified, then what is the process next level? how a developer will be notified back with the issues with tool. So they will be using, this is just for your information, but this is most important. The servers will be there that everyone should know. QA team, if they identify any issues, they will be using some tools, defect management tools. So if they found an issue that is treated as a defect in the development, so there will be defect management tools, ALM tool like this. There are defect management tools. In that tool, they will create a new request. ID will be generated. They will upload the documents with screenshots. This is the expected behavior, but we are getting so and so unwanted results. And in the drop down, they will get your name. They will assign back to you. You have to fix the defect and then unit test it, notify them back to them, assign back to QA team. They will be working on. This is general process. Those who are not working in IT, you should know. Okay, so these many servers. So production live, it is not only one server. I'll talk about multiple servers, load balancer. I thought of telling today, but I'll talk about it. So whenever the application development is done in development server, code will be moved to QA, QA to UAT, UAT to production. After production also, we can maintain one server, which is a copy of production server. That is called as post-production server. Okay, production, everything is fine. Take a copy of production, maintain in post-production. Any issues in production, instead of logging to production, you test it in post-production. If you find post-production issue, that means it is there in production server also. Okay, so post-production is just a copy of your production server. UAT also can be a copy of the same. Now, see in live environment, how they will maintain the servers. Just on top level, let me explain you. Okay, I'll draw here some application architecture. Okay, this is too much in depth. Okay, so now here you go. So this is live environment. In live environment, generally, business will not maintain only one server alone. Okay, that means your live application will not be there on only one machine. It will be deployed on multiple servers. It can be 3 or it can be 4, it can be 2 or it can be 1 also, it can be 100 also. It depends. Suppose if you take Amazon application, it will be there on hundreds of servers, not on one single server. Actually, that management is different. Generally, static design. So now your live server, live environment. So this is server 1, server 2, and this is server 3. Okay, it can be server 4 also, server 5 also, and number of servers. See, your application will be deployed on multiple servers. Same application will be available on multiple servers. This is for the purpose of balancing the load. Generally, suppose you take any application, let's say Flipkart application you have taken. On an average, we have 2000 users. Okay, only one server per minute, you are finding 2000 logins on an average on server. Suppose there is a big sale. Now per minute average, how many members will be there? There can be in millions of logins. Now that time what happens is there will be a lot of burden on the server. Server may get crashed and congestion also will be more. So now maintaining these many servers is to redirect the users logins into different servers at the same. But as an end user, you will not realize that there are multiple servers like that. Okay. So now here you go, whenever a user is trying to log in, so this is user is going to use a browser and he's going to send a request to the application server. So the request first will go to, this is just top level, I'm not talking about authentications and all. So it is going to go to one web server. So this is called as load balancing server. All this will be maintained by admin teams. Now, whenever a request is being made by a requester, so when it reaches load balancing server, request will be redirected to one of the application server based on some parameters. Now, second, another user is there. So some other is when he is going to send a request. User two, when he send a request, so request will first reach load balancing server. Okay, before that there will be a number of things. It will go to server 2. Now third user, So as the number of users are increasing, it is going to redirect these users to different application servers to maintain and balance the load. Let's say user one, user three. This is user two. So now load will be balanced. Okay, all of these servers will connect to only one database, not multiple databases. Database will be one, application will be available on multiple servers. As an end user, you don't feel there are multiple servers and all. So whenever you try to log into Flipkart or Amazon, request will go before the application server, request will go to web server, which is load balancing server, which will maintain the traffic. Okay, congestion control will happen here. So now it will redirect to the application servers. So you will be getting the data from one of the application being accessed from one of the server. Okay, but all these servers database will be one or n? One database or multiple databases? Multiple maintain each one. Database should be only one. Okay, application can be on n servers. Database should be only one database. So everyone should come to same database. Otherwise, there will be a number of problems. Okay, so this is how the basic design of your application servers will be there in production environment. And this is what one should know as a developer. One should know this process. From development, it will go to QA. From QA, it will go to QAT server. Different machines. Servers are nothing but machines. So,
can you explain what is the role of API here? Is API and web, this load balancing server, same? Just a brief introduction.
No, API is different. API is application program interface between multiple applications. Two different applications, when they wanted to communicate, we used to use API is created as a software program. That is a software program. From one request, from one server, it will take, one application will take the request and give it to other application. Take the response, give it to other, something like that, API. Within one application also, we can define APIs. API is a program. We create a document. So for this, instead of document, I think I'll share you this video, which I'm recording now. I share you this video. It is being recorded, right? Okay. So this information, everyone must know if you're applying for any job, okay? So that you can better understand going forward the development at all. Anytime you're talking about servers, someone was asking questions yesterday. So when we are discussing about agents and all, we'll talk about this way only, multi-node environment. This is called multi-node environment, where you have multiple application servers for one application. Okay, everyone clear with this? It's just a brief idea about how this. So can someone please mute? Neha Desai. There's a lot of background noise. Okay, now let's proceed forward. And what we were discussing about yesterday? Rule sets, right? So yesterday's class, which we have discussed, it might be a little bit confusion for you. But as we work on every day, you will be able to understand. But on a single go, when you read it, you'll not be able to remember everything. The matches and all, like organization rule set, organization class. But while we are practicing, you need to make the observation of which class we are choosing, which rule set appropriately we are selecting. So the same practice you'll follow wherever you go. Okay, that is the best practice we are following. So now here you go, where we were talking about rule sets. So rule set is a collection of rules and it can be used for the purpose of versioning. And a rule set version can be created just by clicking on plus icon, which I have shown you. And it can be locked by using password. Okay, what if you forget the password? YouTube channel, there is a video available. You can go and watch it, but it is too early for you to understand that logic. Okay, so now here you go with, let's log into our application. Let's talk more about rule sets. Now let me ask you before we proceed forward. Suppose I have a section, just imagine. Okay, you have to, because you know the rule forms, you should be able to imagine. We have a flow action available created in organization rule set. I'm not going to talk about the classes, only rule sets. Organization rule set, flow action is there. I want to call a section into flow action. Section is there in framework rule set. So should I be able to call or will not be able to call?
You can call.
Is it possible? So you're calling one rule from another rule. Child rule is there in the main rule is there in organization rule set. Child rule is there in framework rule set. Framework rule set rule, can I take it in and call it in the organization rule set rule? Is it possible?
No.
It is not possible. Simply, same practice. Organization class flow action is there. framework class, section is there. Can I call section into organization class? It is not possible. So how we have discussed about inheritance, same way for rule sets also, it is also inheritance. Organization rule set can be accessed anywhere. Anything which is available in organization will be accessible to bottom levels. You cannot include any rule which is there in other rule sets into organization rule set. Only organization rule set rules can be accessed into organization rule set. Suppose you take framework rule set. Flow action is there in framework rule set. Section is there in organization rule set. Can we call the section into flow action?
Yes.
Section is in organization rule set. Flow action is in framework. I am trying to add the section into flow action. Should I be able to add or not?
Yes,
now you tell me, section is there in implementation rule set, implementation work rule set. Flow action is there in framework rule set. We cannot call. Now flow action is there in implementation rule set. Section is there in organization as well as it is there in framework rule set. Some other. Should we be able to access these two?
Yes.
Yes.
It is also like inheritance only. Okay. Everyone clear with this? So that is the point which I have told you yesterday. Going forward, we'll be using multiple rule set rules. Anyway, we started using already, but let's go ahead now and talk more about rule set versions. See, the rule set version which we have locked by using a password. Once you lock the rule set version, we should not be able to create new rules in that same version, or we cannot delete the existing rules from that version. We cannot modify the rules in the version. Suppose given a requirement, you have to modify a rule which has been developed in previous release, previous sprint, which has been already locked. So what you have to do? We have to make a copy of the same into next highest version, which is meant for this sprint, and then make the changes accordingly, save it, done. This is the process we are going to follow going forward. So next I have to talk about check-in, check-out. So many of you are already aware of this, but let me try to tell you for other resources. So for this, before I explain this, I'll give you information about how to create a developer operator ID. Already one operator ID we have created as part of application creation, right? So in order to explain you check-in check-out process and its importance, I need two operator IDs. Those two are developer operator IDs so that I can better explain you. So in this process, I have to create an operator ID. Okay. So I'll give you the screenshots of how to create an operator ID. Okay. Just this is how to create a developer operator ID. So this is by copying existing developer operator ID. Already existing, we have one developer operator ID available. Later point of time, we'll be learning how to create manager operator IDs, user operator IDs, and other different operator IDs by ourselves later. But as of now, we'll take the developer operator ID, which is already available with us, and 572 now, and we'll see how to copy that to create a new one. This is best, just basic navigations for you as of now. So the current operator which you have logged in, if you wanted to open that operator rule form, you need to click on the operator menu at the left bottom corner. You'll be having that. I think you are using it for log off and all. There you see in the menu, you see one of the option called operator. I'm going to give you the screenshot. No need to worry about it. Here you go. Okay. So now here you go, you will be getting this. This is current operator. See, operator means employee in the organization generally. He will be having a title, first name, last name, full name, job position, phone number, email address, other parameters I'll tell you later. So this is existing operator. From existing operator to create a new operator is easy. Instead of creating from the scratch, take one of the operator ID, copy paste it, and change the details. That's it. Okay. Now you just go ahead and save as. Here is the save as to create new one. Okay. So don't do any mistakes while doing this. Save as. I'm trying to save as. Save as means you're just copying. While copying, it will ask you what is the name for the new operator ID which you're going to create by copying the existing operator ID. It is not mandatory that your operator ID should have @something.com. It is not mandatory. So let me go ahead and give like this. This is Tata DevOp 2. Means Tata developer operator 2 for your better understand. So create and open. It should not have spaces. Remember that. Don't give spaces between operator ID. Okay, now you can give name. This is developer 2. Where is it? Developer 2. I can give the full name also same. And it can be anything. developer2@gmail.com. No other details I'm changing. Only full name just to distinguish this operator name from the previous. Save, done, completed. Now you got second operator also created. For this application as of now, we have only one. Now, just now we have created one more. So we have two developer logins. So two developers can at a time log into application server or not. Suppose your application in your real time, look at here, you will not be having startup, shutdown, all this login. How it will be? Your Pega will be installed on some server. Admin teams will maintain that. That is called development server. For that server, they will give you a URL. Once you hit the URL, you will get the login screen. Okay, you will open in your browser. Browser you will open and give the URL, it will get the, like this every other developer can go ahead and log into application server. But here it is only one machine, right? In one machine, how to log in? Because it will maintain session. So you have to take a private session. You take a private window. Login with operator 2 using private window. That means operator 1 and 2 are both are on the server at the same time. Or you can use, suppose you do not want to go with private window, you can use Chrome. One login in Chrome, one login in Firefox, another login in other one like Edge or something.
Usha, what is this private window and how did you open? What is it?
Which one?
You are saying, you know, private window and you, so is it a
private new window? Means you're opening a new session simply. Okay, you're opening a new session to log into PRB. Suppose if you open, suppose same browser, take the URL within the same browser, if you open a new tab and try to enter, it will take you into existing login. Okay. So that's why I've taken new private window. I got a separate session create available. Now, what is the operator ID? Tata DevOp 2. Password is the password of the old operator. If you are not changing again, it will be the password of old operator. Try to log in now. Give that URL copy pasted and try to log in now. So now you can go to dev environment. Now, both of these resources have been given with a requirement. They have to work on the requirement. So as part of their requirement, they are being asked to, they have to work on, let's say, modifying customer details form, for example. Okay, here you go. Where is it? Customer details form, or it can be personal vehicle form also, no problem, but let me take customer details form. So customer details form, they have to modify. This one is customer details form. It is there in version 1, right, which is locked. So what should be done? Save as to version 2. Save as, just I'm doing a save as. So version 2, this is developer 2 or developer 1? Developer 2. Developer 1, okay, now, okay, where is it? This one. He has opened customer form. At the same time, parallelly, developer 1 also opened the customer form. Tata at the same time, developer 1 also logged in. He is trying to open the same rule, customer details form. And he will also have to work on the same rule. Given requirement, he has to add one label here, some label text. For other developer also, he has to add one label. Okay, now developer 2 is parallel, both of them are parallel working on. Just for better understanding, let me go ahead and add a label simply. A label I am taking, and I'm getting the label added here. Somewhere you can add over it. This is for label text, you can give meaningful text. This is added by developer 2. Developer 2. This has been added by developer 2. At the same time, parallelly, developer 1 is working on it. Developer 1, where is it? Label. And this is added by developer 1. Okay. This is what is there. So both of them are working. So now developer 1 has saved, and now developer 2 has saved it. Okay. They have done their changes, they saved it and they closed it. So again, you just open it. Now developer one has opened the role. At the same time, here you go with developer two, customer details section, right? Version two. So developer two you see, and developer one has opened. So both of them are seeing. So one of their changes have been overridden. It has been lost. So whoever has saved latest, last update, only their changes are available. Solution for this is not allowing them to parallelly develop as of now. That we can see later. Solution for this is preventing the developers being worked on parallelly. Okay, we need to prevent these developers to work on a role parallelly. That means one developer is editing a role, other developer should not be able to edit the same role. That is how we have to prevent. Everyone clear with the requirement? So that is our requirement now. For this, the solution is we have to enable check-in check-out feature on rule set level, not on rule level. It is rule set level. Rule set level means all the rules in the rule set will be given with that feature of check-in check-out. Everyone clear with this? Now at this, by default, the check-in check-out feature is not enabled. When it is not enabled, what is the issue? The process command is allowing both of the resources to edit the rule, and save option is available, means they should be able to update it back. Okay, so in order to prevent this parallel development, Pega has given a feature called check-in check-out. That feature we have to enable at the rule set level. Okay, now what is happening, let me show you first. Here you go, rule set security, Tata rule set, right? There is a checkbox which is unchecked. By default it is not selected. What is that? Use checkout. Let me select this and save this. Okay, now close this. What are the buttons you see? Save, action, delete, right? Let me close this and refresh. Just let me refresh everything. After I made some change, now I am trying to open the section. So other operator also has opened the section. Previous to this screen, previous to now, what is the difference you see here? By default, you don't have save option. You have a checkout option. For other operator also, he has checkout option. So currently you see a lock icon enabled. That means this rule currently is in check-in mode. So it is already checked in. By default, whenever I have enabled, everything has been checked in. So during a check-in mode, rule is read only. You cannot edit this rule. So editing means if you have save button available, that means you are editing it. Save button is visible or not? Save is not visible. Save is not visible means you cannot update it back. That means it is in read only mode. Okay, you have to first get this to editable mode, make your changes, save it back, and then check in. Okay, so now currently this is in check-in mode. During a rule is in check-in mode, rule will be read only. You do not have any save button visible, and you see checkout. Checkout means it is saying that you can check out. Now I have checked out this. Okay, now you have save option available. Let's wait. One of the operator has checked out this. Save option is available. That means you make changes, save it back, and you can check in back the changes. I will talk about that one, check in later again. Now other operator, he is trying to check out. What is happening? He is getting a message. Checkout failed. This record original record has been locked by some other operator. Means when you check out, that means when you are editing, process command is locking that instance on your name. No one should be able to edit at the same time. This is clear. Suppose he has closed it. So someone else is modifying. Now he has opened it, not parallelly, after some time while someone is mod. Now, does he have any check-in checkout option at all? First of all, there is any checkout option available? No checkout. Suppose if both of them parallelly open, one of the person will check out, other person, when he try to check out, error message I have shown you. Let's say one guy has opened the rule. He is working on it. After some time, someone else has logged in and tried to open the same rule. Checkout button itself is not visible. Lock is there. If you click on lock, you can see a message. What is the message? This record was checked out by other operator some time back. So someone else is editing this record. You cannot edit this. This private edit, I will tell you later, not now. Private edit is something different. But you can tell me by the label itself. What do you mean by private edit?
you can
impact the other developer. It will be open only for this operator. You cannot check in back those changes also. That is not possible. But leave about it, I'll explain it. But as of now, this is check-in checkout feature. So that we can enable at the rule set level by selecting the option use checkout. So if a rule is currently in check-in mode, means it will display checkout button, save button will not be visible, it is in read-only mode. Rule is currently in checked in means everyone will open, they will see checkout button. Only one of them can edit it by checkout. Other persons, after one person has checked out, someone else try to check out, what will happen? It will display a message. Already someone is editing this rule. You cannot make any changes like that. This is clear, everyone? Now parallel development is prevented completely. Everyone clear with this? So parallel development, this is how we have to prevent the parallel development in Vega by enabling check-in checkout feature. In other technologies also, when you download one file making the modifications or you're modifying, you'll right click on the file in version management tools and you choose the option of lock. When you choose the option of lock, it will be locked on your ID. No one else, generally you will do it while you are updating the changes back to the file. Okay, so no one else should be able to add their changes. After your changes are all done, you are going to unlock it. The same practice. Okay, check in, check out feature. Everyone clear with this? Understand? This is for developers. I will give the screenshots where to enable that options, because we have to enable it for all three rule sets which we are working on. Okay, everyone clear with this?
One small doubt.
Yeah, check in, check out. One second. Generic notes is available. What is check in, what is check out, and how to do it. Practical, I'll give you screenshot for our own rule sets now. Yeah, what is the question online?
No, say for example, developer 1 and developer 2 are working on the same application. Can we see the email IDs or, as you mentioned, like admin IMPL or admin IMPL 2?
Email ID, operator ID, you can see here.
Yeah, operator ID. So in a practical session, like operator ID will be based on the user credentials, or it will be like, is there any other separate format for that?
No, no. Generally, you will create operator ID by yourself, or maybe your tech lead will create and give you. Your LAN ID will be created as operator ID. That means your employee ID for the client. Generally, you take it as operator ID, or you create by yourself anything. No worries. Generally, whichever the organizations have worked on, client ID will be there, right? ID, that ID I used to use as operator ID. That's it.
Harsha, before creating the check-in, check-out option enabling for the rule set, you showed me to the other screen, right? Like you took right click on the data, or where could you please go back to that screen?
This customer details. I will give you the navigation for that enabling option. I will give you the screenshots for that. Don't worry about it. To understand the concept or not, that is important. What is the importance of check-in, check-out, enabling check-in, check-out to prevent parallel development? Someone online was asking what is production tool set. That is too early to discuss about it, but there is a video available in YouTube channel. My channel, you can watch that. Suresh. Yes, someone else was asking question. What was that?
Harsha, what if parallel development is required and the work?
If parallel development is needed, let's say you need to create branch rule sets. So those who are already aware of Pega BRPC, suppose if you're working on Pega since past 3 years or 2 years, if you wanted to know parallel development production rule sets, you can go to my YouTube channel and you type branch rule sets, production rule sets. You'll get one video. All types of rule sets is explained there. Okay, but we'll be coming to that later. Like that, we have to create branch rule sets. One rule set version, two sub branches you'll create. Parallel development you complete, merge the branches into one single version. It can be automatic or it can be manual retrofit. So that is different. So now here you go with check-in check-out feature. When you enable, two developers will not be able to parallelly edit a rule. That's it. So that enabling screenshots I'll give you now. This is done or what? Okay.
Harsha,
I think I thought of showing the issue, right? That is there. The screenshots and everything will be there in the document. Let me show you directly the practical how to enable. Yes, please. You can proceed. You're asking something.
Harsha, it's actually there in three rule sets 01, 02, 03, three versions. So, how to bring 01 version of the action?
How to bring 01 rule? See, whenever you have a rule in 01, 02 versions, when you open by default, BRPC will open 02 only. Here also, it will not show two rules. If you want to see 01, how to see that?
It is available in 01, 02, 03. How to bring 01 version?
How to bring?
01.
Bring means?
Bring means if we want to see that.
That is what I am showing. When you open, it will open always latest version, highest version. Highest version it will show, not at runtime, design time. If you wanted to see previous versions to that, after you open it, go to actions, view versions, and here you'll see 3, 2, 1. You have 10 versions, 10, 9, 8, everything will be shown here. If you choose one, one will be opened. But at runtime, always highest version will be picked.
Okay.
Now here you go. So this can be enabled at rule set level, not on individual rules. This can be enabled at rule set level. Okay, bulk check-in and all I'll tell you. Now here you go where enable this for organization, implementation, FW, rule sets, not for integrations, only for. So you know how to open all these rule sets, right? I'm not going to give the screenshot of application and rule set, click on edit icon, rule set will be open. You know how to come to this screen. Okay, after you come to organization screenshot, you need to select this checkbox. Go to security tab. This is for organization rule set. Go to security tab. Only for the first one I'm going to write down. So you need to select the option use checkout. Select about checkbox and save. Done. Repeat same for IMPL and FW rule sets. Save, completed. So how to open IMPL FW rule sets? Application, this is IMPL rule set, security tab. Need to select this option. Save this. So now next, after this, framework rule set.
Harsha, like when we are opening this framework application and implementation application, somewhere we while we are opening the rule set, one place we can see that application rule set, and another place we are seeing like rule set validation.
That's so, what, if you wanted to know about these things, production rule sets, branch rule sets, all this. This one you're talking about?
No. Not this one. Could you please go to that first part, like framework application.
This is framework application.
And somewhere like a rule set validation. Yeah, here.
That is.
Here.
This is different.
Yeah.
I'll tell you this. Not now.
Okay.
It is too early. We'll be working on all those things. That is also part of PRBC design. Okay, so this is how you can just go ahead and enable check-in checkout. This moment onwards, any rule you create, by default, once you save, it will be checked in. Later, if you want to make modifications, check out and make modifications, and then save that rule back to, sorry, check-in back to that particular version. Well, this is a daily day-to-day practice. Okay, so yesterday onwards, we were discussing about rule set versions, and enabling check-in checkout feature and locking the rule set versions. This is a daily repeated practice for every release, and check-in checkout is a daily practice when you are doing development. Okay, that is with respect to tool, not in our business process. So let's talk about another one. So before we proceed to our business requirement, see your workflows which you have created. Workflow we created, you remember? This is the flow. One or more flows. Not here, I'm sorry. Either it is in framework or implementation, you would have created your workflows. This is the workflow which I have created. So as a developer, I'm going to log into BRBC and open the flow, execute it from the action. This is only for developer perspective. What about business users? So far, whatever we are seeing is developer. How business users access BRBC applications. So that means they need an operator ID, they need a password. Okay, so whenever a business user, when I say business user, that user can be of any type. Okay, he can be a manager, he can be a user, he can be an analyst, he can be a reviewer, he can be a verification team, part of verification team, he can be approver, it can be anyone. Anyone as a business user, when they log in, they will not see all this stuff. Let me close the private window. They will not see all this developer studio. Developer studio, or you call it as designer studio. This is for only developers. As a developer, we are just trying to log into BRPC and open the flow and execute it. Business users, they cannot see, they cannot open the flow and go to action dropdown and they cannot run it. Business users, how they will get the screens is, this is one of the OTP screen available in Pega for managers. So if you click on launch web interface and choose that, this is also for your information. After your testing is done in the developer tool, you have to log in with one of the other business user ID and you have to again test the same. It is taking too long. Let me refresh or what? Refresh this once.
Harsha, I have a question.
Yes, please.
Harsha, if in QA testing, if they find a defect and assign to a developer, how to get corresponding version has done the rule set only, right?
Developers? What is the
Yeah, actually, if a defect is raised by a tester, it is assigned to developer, right? So, how to get the corresponding version?
Your voice is breaking. How to get?
How to get the corresponding code?
Code, because you have developed it, you know where it is.
Yeah, it is there in QA, right? So how to get that?
No, it will be there in development environment also. After you do the development, you move it to QA, means take a copy of what you have done and just install it in QA. It will be there in development environment also.
Sure. I had a question regarding rule sets.
Yes, please.
See, like if you open application rule form and the framework, I mean the implementation application rule form and framework application rule form, right? Both are showing Tata related rule sets, the organization level rule sets.
Correct.
So why can't we delete the organization rule sets in the implementation application? Since implementation application only inherits the rule sets from framework, right?
This is a good question. See, his question is, now someone answer this. If you open implement, so already we have seen rule forms, right? If you open implementation application, you are seeing four rule sets. That is implementation rule sets and organization rule sets. Open framework application, framework rule sets, organization rule sets are available, right? From implementation application, I should be able to access implementation rule sets, framework rule sets, organization rule sets, because organization is built on implementation. Question is, why we need to maintain organization rule sets in implementation application when the same is maintained in framework? Because let's say you have in implementation, you have only implementation rule set, framework rule set, you have framework rule sets plus organization rule sets. Now, anything which is available in framework and organization, you will be able to access. Then why again you are maintaining the organization rule sets in implementation application? That is the question. If you make it available in organization, it will be available for both. For sure. Question is, it is maintained already in framework. You are referencing through framework, which will be accessible to implementation also. Then why again process commands? This design is like, it is all also mentioned in implementation. What is the reason for that?
Because implementation application has the parental inheritance pattern inheritance.
This is I have already told this in other way around. So the how process commander has to watch for the rules, look for the rules. If it is there in implementation, first implementation. If not in implementation, then it should go to organization. Suppose you don't mention the organization rule set in implementation application, it will go to parent application. In the parent application, what is the order? Framework. Instead of looking up organization, if not in implementation, it is taking from framework, which is wrong. For that reason, we have mentioned organization rule set again in implementation application. So that order will be implementation, organization, framework. Again, it will not go for organization finally. That is not needed actually. Okay, this is clear. So again, why we have mentioned in framework is because first it has to verify in framework and then it has to go to organization. That's why organization rule sets are mentioned in all applications. N number of applications you have, that order should not be missed. Suppose if you remove organization rule set from implementation application, maybe there is an issue server. I'll take it tomorrow, remaining part. Suppose if you do not mention in organization rule set, implementation application, if you do not mention organization rule sets, what is the issue? After it is going, it will try to look from the implementation first, current application. If not, it will go to parent application. When it go to parent application, which rule set it will first access? Same order, framework, which is wrong. It has to access after implementation, it has to go to organization, then it has to go to framework. Okay, for that design approach, it is following, it is giving like organization rule sets in all applications. Clear?
Yes, sir. Sure. I have similar question to some point. Like, so if we uncheck that pattern inheritance in class rule form,
I'll talk about it. We are to discuss about it.
Okay.
Pattern inheritance in the classes will be.
Harsha, can we get any requirement like we want to do in this? I mean, for again, practical. Can we get a requirement we want to do in the framework only, or can we want to do in these classes only like that?
Okay.
Or
this one also, let me tell you. See, after giving the requirement, when you are analyzing, you should come to know this is part of framework or implementation. Business sometimes will tell, sometimes will not tell. See, generally in some of the organizations, suppose if you join JP Morgan, framework is separating, implementation is separating. Means, suppose you got a requirement, you think like it has to be modified at framework level, you will redirect to framework team. Framework team will develop that and they will give you, and you have to take that code and make it available in your implementations. Okay, that is how you have to do. Some organizations, it is not like that. Some projects, you might have to work on framework application or implementation. Whatever the type of application, ultimately development is development. But how they are maintaining is different. Okay, framework, there can be separate team. Implementation, there can be separate team, or both can be same. As a developer, you should be able to understand even a requirement should be created in framework or implementation. Maybe your tech lead will tell you, or you have to know by yourself based on its scope of accessibility and all. Sometimes business analyst in the requirements also, they'll write this is part of framework application design. Okay, I think 90% it will be written. Okay, sometimes they will not bother about it. Business analyst doesn't have complete knowledge about it, they cannot write down that. Okay, business anyway, they will not know what is framework, what is implemented. They know only accessing application requirement. Business analyst will have some information about it, but tech leads will have complete details about development as well as functional. Okay, so it depends.
And one more thing, same extension of the same question. So in the Jira or whatever, maybe when we are getting any requirements, so are they, in practical, are we giving any screenshots or flow navigation like that, or
again, it depends. See, if you are being given with a user interface design, they may give you the screen's design, appearance, everything they will give you, maybe developed into some other things like that. Or they may tell you simply in the requirement as a wording and all, you have to understand it and do it. It depends on that. See, if they have to give you user interface screen design and all, they have to work a lot in the background, which will be really difficult for them. I think pretty less number of times you'll get such kind of visible UI given to you to replicate it. Suppose your application is already running in .NET, which you are again developing into Pega, then you will be given with all screenshots, this is how it should look like. Otherwise, they will simply write down, you have to imagine and then design you complete and just present them. If they're okay or they tell you changes, you have to do accordingly. Rule sets, did I send you that document? Okay, check in, check out, something is there. This one, did I send you?
Harsha, are you sharing this recording also?
No, we didn't get rule set or check in, check out.
Rule set, I have shared it, okay, yesterday. Second secret I'm sharing now, 572, right? Listen,
could you,
this one, what we were discussing about,
only got like type of rule set, but we didn't get any detail there.
Let me send it today. No worries. Rule set, right?
Yeah.
This one. Okay, you can wind up for today. We'll continue from there, like how businesses are going to access the workflows. That I'll tell you tomorrow. After that is completed, we can proceed with our regular development. Okay. Yeah. Yes, please. I'm sorry about it. People are dispersing here. There's a lot of noise. Hemant, can you give a message, please?
If you see my mail, you will get it.
Mail? You sent a mail?
Yeah, yeah, if you see.
This one. Yeah. What is that? Hemant.
Yes.
I will check your emails, Hemant. I'll respond to you. Okay.
Yes.